Welcome. Hey, it's your girl, Miss J, on Be Exposed Radio, live at the Sugar Shack. We are here another day. We are here. Yes, ring the bell. I'm excited. I had an alright day. How about you, my booty boo?
My day was pretty good. I wish this mic would act correctly, but my day was pretty good. I had a little altercation the other night, but hopefully that altercation is just going to work itself out over time.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
You want to share?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
I don't want to share.
I understand. Well,
look what the cat dragged in.
Let's get us started.
Hello, everybody.
Who are you?
I am Miss Versatile, your co-host.
How is your day, honey?
It was an interesting day.
Because it's what? Hump Day Wednesday?
Girl, it was an interesting day, but...
Get your baby!
Yes. Get your baby.
Get my baby.
We have a great show.
I'm so excited.
Lined up today, Shackers and Shackettes. Yes, we do. We have one author, Ms. Denise DaCosta. She has a book and an upcoming film called Tony's Tragedy in Arizona. Can't wait to talk to her. Then we have motivational speaker and author, Chris Braga. Yes, he's going to give us some great pointers about powerful being you and just... I can't wait.
I'm excited to talk to him and just to hear what he has to say about how we can transform our lives into what we want it to be.
Mm-hmm. Because we all need that. I know I do. I'm always trying to better myself every minute of the day, of what I can do better for the world, what I can do better for myself, what I can do better for my family. It's all about improving, because there's no such thing as I can't improve myself. No such thing.
And there's no such thing as perfection.
Exactly. And it's no such thing as being on a higher plateau either, because the quicker you get up, the quicker you'll go down. Boom.
Crash.
Fire.
And burn.
And burn. Was that the baby gun? Okay. All right. So, interesting enough, our at the Sugar Shack question of the day. What is worse, a scorned woman or a scorned man? Bless you.
Thank you.
In the aftermath of a relationship.
Well, you said the question was, what's the...
Who is worse?
Who is worse, the scorned man or the scorned woman at the end of a relationship?
Mm-hmm.
It depends on what happened to who.
I was going to say that.
Well, a lot of people, both male and females, are getting the boot or whatever you want to call it. So there's like no love laws in relationships anymore. It used to be the woman, but I hear a lot of stories from guys that they are getting booted even quicker.
I was
quicker.
Dating this one girl, and she cheated on me. 6 out of the 9 months we were talking to each other.
Wow.
So that's like 3 months of commitment.
Non-commitment.
No. It was 3 months of commitment.
Wait. But technically...
And it was 3 months of non-commitment, too.
So, how did you find out?
Well, it was kind of, you know, high school. We broke up, and then my friend, he was like, yeah, man, I heard her talking to somebody else, and he was kind of like, you know, so did you really love Rob or did you not love him? She was like, I mean, I kind of did. And then I just started talking to this other guy, and I'm kind of like, why did you just tell me? So we could have been cut it off, you know?
Well, the question to that is, okay, so you always are in a relationship and somebody says, well, I heard this and I heard that. Do you go by, I heard this and I heard that, or you rather see it for yourself, or once you hear about it, you'll pull your mate up and say, okay, I'm bringing this to your attention. What is this about? Do you feel necessary to believe people? Because sometimes people have other intentions pertaining to your relationship. So, what do you think about that?
Well, I'm more of a, I don't believe you, I believe her. Or it's kind of like, just tell me what really happened. And just tell me, make sure you tell me the truth. Tell me what really happened.
But then some people are just liars.
Yeah.
And tell you what you want to hear.
Mm-hmm. I know
tell them what they want to hear.
Well, I don't know a lot
tell
about that, but everybody's done that at least once or twice.
Telling somebody what they want to hear? But why? Because the person is hurt anyway if they're coming to you stating, I know these facts about you, so why continue to pacify the person? Because that's what you're doing. You're putting a band-aid over a sore.
True.
And that person is already hurt. So why put that cheap band-aid on that big sword that's not going to fit?
We need some different background music for this topic.
You said cheap?
Cheap band-aid. Cheap. That's how you feel?
Yeah, we're just going to switch the background
okay.
music.
Okay, all right.
When a woman's fed up.
When a woman is fed up.
Ain't nothing you can do about it.
No. Hide your baby. She coming for you. She coming. Don't let a woman get scorned. It is nothing like, from a woman's perspective, it is nothing like a woman scorned. Because I've been scorned. I've had some things, you know, that transpired. But luckily, I'm cool with all my exes.
Same here.
That's a good
so
one.
Every last one
of them. So, now, on the end of one of them, yeah, things got a little funky and I kind of came out of character on, you know, Mr. I won't say his name, but, you know, a lot of people know about it. I did some out of body things that a woman.
Out of character things.
I was like, out of body.
Right.
Out of body, out of mind.
Kind of.
Crazy things. Yeah, I did. Because when a woman is fed up and she's taking a lot, you forget who you are. Because the person that you went in the relationship was calm, cool, and collected. And you try to stay that way, but then people try to play you. Play you for stupid. And one thing I believe people are not are stupid. One thing women, God gave women was intuition. And women ride on intuition. When they think something is not right, chime in, sister.
100% of the time, we are right.
Yes. That's the one thing that God blessed a woman with was intuition. And I'm sorry, men don't have it.
I got an intuition.
No, it's not called intuition.
What is it then?
Good judgment, maybe.
For a man or for a woman?
Not have intuition.
Oh. Yeah. I can see good judgment, but intuition, no.
So like, explain what. So tell me again, because maybe I didn't hear the definition. What is your definition of women's intuition?
A woman, from my perspective, because I can only speak for myself. You have two eyes, you have two arms, you have two legs, you have one brain. But it's that little thing in your brain, it's probably about the size of a pea, that stays there.
Oh, I'm sorry. I just had to look it up, and we may be wrong. Men may have.
That is outright lies.
Intuition is like I say here, a sixth sense. I'm looking at WebMD magazine online, and talk about the power of women's, of female's intuition. Intuition or a sixth sense is something many of us rely on for snap judgment and often life-altering decisions. But what exactly is it?
It's that little thing in your brain. Right. Little tiny thing in your brain, like I said. Everybody has it. It's just women use it more than men. So
it says, just like the brain, there are neurotransmitters in the gut that can respond on environmental stimuli and emotions in the now. It's not just about past experiences. Like, it's it says, when those neurotransmitters fire, you may feel the sensation of butterflies or uneasiness in the stomach. Researchers theorize that gut instinct, which sends signals to your brain, plays a large role in intuition.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it says men and intuition, and again, this is from WebMD.com. And contrary to common belief, it's not just women who harbor this mysterious instinct. Men can be powerfully intuitive. They have the same capabilities as women. Well, that's something that I'm glad that we had this, we're having a discussion and I was able to read up on, because I honestly thought that men didn't have it. But as WebMD says, men do. They can be powerfully intuitive. But in our culture, we view intuition as something that's warm and fuzzy or not masculine. So men have often lost touch with those feelings. So, gentlemen, you guys have it, but you have to
tune into it.
You have to tune into it and activate it.
Because it's just sitting there.
Sitting there.
Festering.
Mm-hmm. For instance, it says, American women, on the other hand, are encouraged to be receptive to their inner thoughts, so it appears that they have more intuition than men. The reality is, girls are praised for being sensitive, while boys are urged to be more linear in their thinking rather than listen to their feelings. You gotta listen to your feelings, guys.
And not hide behind them.
I listen to my feelings. Maybe that's a bad thing.
No. God, I always say God made you for who you are. So everyone does not rely on their feelings because they don't know how to express their feelings. Mm-hmm. So if a person who doesn't know how to express their feelings, you could be sitting here having a heart-to-heart conversation with them and being honest, and they don't feel anything.
Yeah, like, I know that's one of the problems I have. I don't know if it's because I'm a Scorpio or not, but it's really hard for me to express the way I feel about really, really, really serious things.
And see, we were just having a conversation, my cousin and my neighbor, the other day, that she said when her, you know, she has one daughter and three boys, and when her boys were growing up, and if one of them, you know, fell and bust their lip or hurt themselves, she wouldn't tell them to suck it up. She would say, cry, it hurts, it's okay, be in touch with your emotions, be in touch with your feelings, because she didn't want, you know, them to not have any feelings, you know. So it says here, so how do you tune in to your intuition? First, pay attention to your physical responses. Maybe you're trying to decide if you take a new job that pays twice the salary as your current one. Your head says, of course, that's a lot of money. But you notice there's a feel, you feel a little sick to your stomach or exhausted. There's an intuitive cue that you should step back and really examine the offer. You also need to make sure you aren't mistaking strong emotions for intuition. Fear, desire, and panic can all get in the way of intuition. It's important to focus on that inner voice.
I got a question.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think it's good to lie to people to protect them?
Lying is never good. Not sure how I feel about this. Withholding information until a later date. It's not lying, but I don't know. Some people say that I do that. That I don't necessarily lie, but I may not withhold, but hold back. Not like you ask me and I lie about it, but I may not just say something right away. So that's something I think about too. It's not a form of lying, but what is it? Is that bad? Lying is never good, to answer your question.
You know why I try not to lie? Because growing up, I used to get lie bumps. on my tongue.
Oh, yes, those are real.
Yes, they are.
Yes, they are. And a star in your eye.
I never got the star in my eye, but I always would get a live bump. Yes. On the side of my tongue.
Oh, my God.
On the tip of my tongue.
Yes.
I thought they came in the back.
No.
No, that's from eating certain things. I know what that is.
Yeah.
No, I didn't mean that. I'm talking about, oh, my gosh. Because I've gotten that bump, and I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about maybe if you're eating French fries or, like, a burger and you drink something, and you have a bump in the form of the back of your tongue. I've had that before. But, no, seriously, those lie bumps are real, and I'd rather be hurt by the truth than hurt by a lie.
Live bumps are true, I can tell you. Yes. As a teenager, yes. I would lie. Yes. Stupid things. And never realized when I was getting these live bumps what they were about. So truly I understand and I learned from it. Don't lie. It's not worth it.
So if you want to call in to chime in about a man being scorned or a woman being scorned, who's worse in the aftermath, or if you want to talk to us about lies and lie bumps and is it good to lie, intuition, or if you want to talk about intuition, give us a call at 1-855-835-5857 extension 1, or text us at 443-642-9403.
It was crazy. Because I never really talked about a lie bump before.
I know, it's real.
And it's real.
It is real.
So somebody put, how do you get rid of a lie bump? And...
on the page?
Tell the truth.
And it's saying the problem is more common that you might think. The true cause of them is unknown, but scientists believe it can be triggered by a variety of factors, including stress, vitamin D12 deficiency, indigestion, trauma to the tongue, bitten accidentally, for example, eating spicy, salty, sour foods, etc. Therefore, a long-term solution includes trying out a variety of remedies, including lowering your stress level, which is beneficial anyways for a wide range of reasons, taking vitamin B12 supplements, and so on and so forth. Good oral hygiene is always helpful as well. Immediate treatments are not always successful and results vary among individuals, but the remedies include chewing mint leaves, research of these home treatments thoroughly beforehand since they aren't medically official and may not have any undesired side effects. Don't lie.
Right.
That's the bottom line. Don't lie. It's not worth it. My God. And them things hurt. Lie bumps hurt. And they don't come, like, small. Mine would come right here on the side. You know, this little dimple on the side of your tongue. That's where mine would be.
I know what you're talking about. That's what you're talking about.
You're looking at me like I've never experienced that.
I don't want to. I'm never going to lie again.
Have you ever had a paper cut?
Yeah.
It stings like that. It's irritating.
Ooh.
That's the best way of putting it. A paper cut.
Mm-hmm.
Paper cuts are so annoying. Cause it's like,
that's what a live bump is. It's very annoying because you know that it's there.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't get rid of it until it heals itself. So that's... I have to post this. Are you posting that about a live bump?
No.
I have to do that. That is crazy. Oh my goodness. So, when a scorned woman, let's say, what do you think could be the worst thing a scorned woman could do? Because I can imagine what a woman could do versus what a man would do.
Bust the windows out your car.
Mm-hmm. Bust my windows out your car. I was going to say something to that. And Prince said it best. Not the ride, baby. Don't mess with a man's ride. I think that's the worst thing a woman could do. The ride, definitely, and his clothes.
Mm-hmm. He's not the...
Not the clothes.
Not the Jordans.
Not the Jordans. Yeah.
I did that.
Mm.
Yeah. I bleached them up, cut them up.
So I got a question. What do you get? What do you get out of the cutting up a material thing? Like something that can be replaced.
But see, but when you're in the middle of that, you don't worry about that. The financial part. You're getting satisfaction.
It's a feeling. It's like an adrenaline rush.
Yes.
I'm not saying that because I've experienced that. Look how Robbie's looking at me. No.
Your baby.
I've never messed up anyone's car.
No, I've never done that.
And I've never messed with anyone's clothes.
Like I said, I've done that.
No, I haven't done any of that.
But like, why?
But this was years ago.
Why are you throwing bleach in my suit?
I did that.
I think the best thing for a man or a woman to do who scorn, just move the fuck on and just grind and get your success on. And you know, they'll just be looking at you like, oh damn, I fucked up. That's the best thing you can do to somebody. Seriously.
I can show you better than I can tell you.
Exactly.
And that comes better with age. Like I said, when you're going through that turmoil of that relationship that you feel slighted, jilted, disrespected, I can just keep going down the line with definitions. And you want to say, you know what? After I wipe these tears, heal this heart, I'm going to get you. But I'm going to get you better than I can show you and tell you I'm going to get you.
You know what I like to do? I like to get people mentally. Yeah.
Exactly. You're a definite Scorpio. Yeah. Scorpios, they'll hit you. They'll hit you. They're not going to hit you in the pockets. They're not going to hit you financially. There's like it's emotional thing.
I'm going to attack your mind.
Exactly. You're going to fuck with your mind.
Ooh.
Well, these are the top 10 things a woman will do.
I'm sorry. I'm going to mind fuck you.
That a woman will do to a man. And all of these are pretty reasonable, too, that I can see a woman doing. Dipping his toothbrush in the toilet.
Oh, yeah.
Giving it its final run around the inner room.
Oh, my God.
I can see that. I've never done these things. I've never done these things, but I can see a woman doing that. Call him and hang up several times, innocent enough until after the 100th or so when he decides he has to change his number. Resend it to all those he wishes to hear from. Best he gets a smartphone with a number block feature right from the start. Call his wife or his current girlfriend and bring her up to speed on his situation. Show up at his work causing a bunch of ruckus.
See, you can't play with anybody. Now I ain't gonna lie. I threaten to. I will come to your job. I will say that. I ain't gonna lie. I can tell the truth in here and at the Sugar Shack. But I don't go to anybody's job. I really don't, because I'm not gonna mess with my livelihood. I don't want to mess with anybody to mess with mine. But I will say, you know what? I'm on my way to your job right now.
Get them all riled up. Get them all riled up. Oh my gosh, she's coming to my job.
Not my job.
Not my job. What's she gonna come to my job?
And I'm coming
for
to my rollers and my
slippers. Oh, the worst. The worst. Swipe his favorite items of clothing before leaving his place for the last time.
Swiping? What you mean swiping?
Stealing his clothes.
Swiper, no swiping.
I'm sorry.
No swiping.
Swiper, no swiping.
Damage his car. Tell everyone he knows what an asshole he really is. Let the air out of his tires.
That's so stupid. Like.
Sit in the car in front of his house and just see what he's up to. Now that's stalking.
Yeah.
That's just straight up stalking.
Somebody's watching me.
Isn't it the same car that's been sitting there in the tinted windows? Just
your neighbor's talking.
Your neighbor's
talking. I think your ex-girlfriend's outside again.
Leave anonymous notes that vent her anger on the windshield of his car. Stalking.
All those, they're just wrong.
Stalking.
It went from immature.
Like straight
to
up
just stalker.
Stalker.
Like, I know where you live.
So I'm saying that every woman is prone to this type of behavior. There are many who've matured beyond acting out and simply letting go. However, I wager a bet that every woman has been scorned one day of their lives. And they've done something. Some are honest and some are not. They just want to keep that part hidden. And some of them are plotting now. So.
Are you plotting against me?
Some are plotting now on how I'm going to get back at them.
So, you know, like, if you damage anything of mine, the one thing that I wouldn't want you to damage are my magic cards.
Don't, why would you say that?
Because I'm not going to let that happen.
You're not supposed to let it out the bag.
No, you're not supposed to tell nobody. Right.
See, that's my, that's part of my mind game.
Okay. Well, we're going to go on to the men. We can't leave them out. So there are five types of men. What do you think they are?
Why don't you let us know?
Well, you have the ones that scream, I'm not a scorned man, but those are the ones, they have trust issues, 365, 24/7, everyday attitude problems. Men are dogs, they rant about the sight of anyone with a male genitalia and basically saying, it's about me, it's about me. The man whore.
Ah.
These guys' behavior speaks for itself. As they go up in age and have a focus on bigger things, such as a career and kids, a man having multiple women in his corner only means one thing, he's scorned. The man whore feels no need to have a substantial relationship because all women suck.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have four more, but I know we're going to go to break, and I don't want to start the other ones. So, this is Miss J.
And Miss Versatile.
Live at the Sugar Shack on Be Exposed Radio, and we'll be back.
I'm LeVar Burton, and I'm proud to be a book person. How do I choose a book? Sometimes it's the cover, sometimes it's the title. I guess I'm pretty visual. If a book's really impressing me and the writing is really good, I will peek and see what the last paragraph is. Because the endings of books should rock you. I am a book person, and if you're a book person too, read to a child and spark a lifetime of ambition. Join me at bookpeopleunite.org because reading is fundamental. A public service announcement brought to you by Reading is Fundamental, Library of Congress, and the Ad Council.
Green light. Hey girl, school zone. I'm getting hungry. Car changing lanes. You want to meet me for pizza? Stop sign. Intersection clear. Yeah, street. Pizza sounds good. Ball in street? Girl in street!
It's hard to concentrate on two things at once, like texting and driving. Stop the text, stop the wrecks. How will you stop texting and driving? Tell us at stoptextstoprex.org. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Check out what you missed on the Lady Yo Show.
To our nutritional program, our producer is
here. You got a phone call coming in right now.
Okay, great.
Say hello.
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 Hello. It's
that's Sharon.
Sharon, hi, Sharon. How you doing tonight?
this is not a Sharon. Who's that?
Oh,
she's gonna be anonymous. I hate it.
Oh, you're supposed to be anonymous. Okay, I understand.
That's okay. I was really gonna play it, but I was like, she's probably figuring out who you are, Sharon. So just stop. Hi, how was your first show?
It's great.
Am I live?
Excited.
Am I live?
Yes.
Oh yeah. Hey y'all. How y'all doing? So how was your first show?
So far, great. I'm excited and just nervous, but we're going to rock it out. He's making me feel, my producer is making me feel comfortable. So I'm here with him.
That's what he
does. I'm in his capable hands.
Yeah, he'll loosen up in a couple of weeks, so just, I'm warning you, it gets real.
It gets, oh God. So I'm almost nervous now. I think
they prayed up, man. They prayed up.
So I'm going to have to stay prayed up. I'm going to have to go to the altar on a daily basis.
Maybe you can take Marty with you.
And I need to put him on the altar.
Oh, you know I'm not going.
Well, you know what? I'm going to take him to church with me. I'm going to get some, dump some oil on his head.
Well, I just wanted to call because I'm on my way home. I just left my office, and I just wanted to call and wish you congratulatory on your first show.
Thank you so much, Sharon. Thank you. I appreciate that.
You want to phone? Okay, it's hot, y'all, so I'm hanging up.
Bye.
Have a good evening. Bye.
Love you, too. Bye. Thanks a lot for calling in.
And that is Sharon from the Let's Talk show that comes on every Wednesday at 8 p.m.
Great. Awesome. So that was great. She checked in on my first show. I feel honored.
So check out the Lady O Show each and every Thursday right here on BeExposedRadio.com.
From north, east, south, and west, you're listening to BeExposedRadio.com. From north, east, south, and west, you're listening to BeExposedRadio.com.
We're rewarding you for something you already do, listening to us. It's radio loyalty, and it's an easy way for you to get free stuff. All you do is sign up. Go ahead and click the banner now. You'll earn points as you listen. Points you can trade in for great products and services in the radio loyalty store. You can earn even more points when you share your favorite station with friends on Facebook and Twitter. Radio loyalty, it's free to sign up. So click the banner to join now.
So, you know, I'm a dog. And I'm kind of new to this family, but I've noticed a trend. My humans do this thing where they go around and get all my toys and hide them in this basket. But it's always the same basket, and it's always the same place. And then they act so surprised when I find them. But I'm like, hello? That's where you put it last time. Humans are the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
A person is the best thing to happen to a shelter pet. Be that person. Adopt. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the ShelterPetProject.org.
Oh my gosh, I can't believe you missed this on Talk Lately.
I wonder, because I'm going to pick up the copy of this, the Cosmo. The phone call, here's what she said. The phone call this April ended the mystery. He left a message on Sunday saying, I have something important to talk about. Please call me back. I was working and called the next morning. He uttered an eerily familiar phrase, you may want to sit down. Then he said, Carolyn, I'm gay. She says, I was stunned. I managed to say after a silent moment and then a deep breath, I had no idea. I'm sure a huge weight is off your shoulders. During all those years I had known him, I never would have guessed that he would come out as gay. We talked again briefly that night. He answered a few questions. Did you know what those questions was? Are you a bottom? That was uncalled for. That was uncalled for. Sorry. 7 foot bottom.
It goes down just like that. Each and every Tuesday and Thursday at 7 p.m. right here on BeExposedRadio.com.
From north, east, south, and west, you're listening to BeExposedRadio.com.
I can't believe that McDonald's, this suit has been given the thumbs up for the go-ahead. Did you see this in the newspaper today? Federal court appealed said yesterday that two heavy, overweight teenagers have the okay to jumpstart their stalled lawsuit against McDonald's. The pause was put on the lawsuit back in December of 2003. Like, hold on.
We're rewarding you for something you already do, listening to us. It's radio loyalty, and it's an easy way for you to get free stuff. All you do is sign up. Go ahead and click the banner now. You'll earn points as you listen. Points you can trade in for great products and services in the radio loyalty store. You can earn even more points when you share your favorite station with friends on Facebook and Twitter. Radio loyalty, it's free to sign up, so click the banner to join now.
Repeat.
Welcome back. Hey, it's your girl, Miss J.
And Miss Persatel.
I'm at the Sugar Shack on BeExposedRadio.com. Yay, we're back. Great topic conversation because everyone has gone through, they know someone that's gone through, they know someone, everybody knows someone that is a scorned man or a scorned woman. So I wanted to pick up where we left off. And the second part. part of a male being scorned is the non-committer. Ever had an ex-boyfriend call you months or even sometimes years later and confess that you are the best thing that ever happened to him? And in your mind, you can't help but to wonder, so why in the hell aren't we together? You met the non-committer. He will date you, court you, but you will never go to that extra step because the relationship has already failed before it started.
Been there, done that.
The scared guy. He will date you, but never commit. He is scared to ever give his all again.
Ooh.
The difference between him and the non-committer is he will eventually have a relationship again. However, he will most likely settle for the safer girl. She's usually less attractive, more submissive, and more loyal than the beauty that once broke his heart.
Well, not necessarily all the beautiful ones are less loyal. I'm beautiful. I'm loyal.
I know I'm beautiful, and I know I'm damn sure I'm
this
loyal.
This queen is loyal. I'm sorry.
Can you feel it? Can you feel it? I know I'm damn sure loyal and committed when I'm in a relationship. So, the secretive guy, it says...
Oh, my goodness. You can have all these in one. Go ahead.
Exactly. Dang, you asked lots of questions. Is this the guy only defense against normal, commonly asked questions? He's so scared to give a woman any information about his past or feelings because she will only use it to hurt him. So he says it will take a high-powered CAT scan to get into his scorned man head. Oh, my God. Lastly, the bromantic. Last but certainly not least.
This is the bromantic?
Bromantic.
I love it.
He's the guy would rather hang with his friends than be with you. He's not just that. He's just not into you or doesn't want to spend too much time with you. Or he likes you, but he's scared, secretive, and non-committer, and he enjoys being a man whore. And that is your statistics for a scorned man. And all of those are true. Don't roll your eyes.
Don't roll your eyes, Robin.
Do not roll
I've
your
dated,
eyes. I've dated. I ain't none of them.
I've dated a few of them. And I've dated some that was all wrapped in one.
Exactly. That's the same.
I think the funniest show is, dang, you asking a lot of questions like, what? I asked you what your sign was. What do you mean I'm asking you a lot of questions?
Right. Hey, what shoe size are you? What? Why are you asking me that? Like, maybe because I want to buy you a pair of shoes. But one thing I don't
I
do.
I know. They say you don't buy a man no pair of shoes.
No, baby. I don't do that.
You will walk out your life in them same shoes.
I do not buy men shoes.
My mama told me that. I don't know how great you that is.
So can that same rule apply, like you can't buy a girl a purse?
I would say maybe shoes, but not a purse.
Mm-hmm.
Look, Robbie said, I bought this lady a purse. I bought this young lady a purse.
She wearing it with another guy.
She's stepping and tipping.
And when she opened up that purse, she's like, my purse sure is pretty.
Look, and with the next man money.
With the next man money.
Me. I
That's the crazy thing, that a woman majority knows all these criteria of a man. Somewhere in their life, they've come across a man, either like you said, that fit all five of criteria of this. They've dated someone. He might have been one of these items, but we know a lot of non-committers and a lot of secretive people.
Sure
too. Like, why are you so secretive? Like, what are you hiding? You don't work for the FBI, so what are you hiding?
Why are you asking me so many questions?
You are the hood now, baby.
Why are you asking me so many questions?
And then, so, let's say you're dating someone who fits the criteria of all five of these. then you have a woman who has the same criteria. Do you think that's a match?
That's gonna be the most dysfunctional relationship like ever.
It's going down in flames before it even starts.
The whole thing.
Like, how can you, both of you, be secretive? Both of you can't be committed to each other.
Right.
She got her bestie. You have your bromance. And you're not meeting in the middle except as a boo thing. That's it.
That ain't gonna work.
That's not gonna work. Is either I'ma hit it and quit you faster than you hit the and quit me. Oh, that's too funny. Do you know any female whores? She whores?
Yeah.
They're proud?
Are they proud of
being a she whore?
Yeah.
That's funny, a she whore.
I know a couple of he whores and she whores. He whores.
Do you know any she whores?
I know a few she whores. I don't judge.
No judge, please. Because I know a few myself. Oh, boy. Shout out to the she whores and he whores.
He whores and the she whores.
She whores and he whores. Oh, God. Whew. So, that topic has sparked a lot of different things. Because that can go into a whole lot of different scenarios of, once again, two people that are not compatible that for some reason in their mind think that they can make it. Then you already know, like I said, you have the ones that just want to do the hit it and quit it and keep it moving. But then you have the ones who for some reason think they're the god and the goddess of the world. And it's nothing wrong with being confident. But I think if you're overly confident, that's a turn off.
I hate a cocky Negro. I really do.
Yeah.
Like you said, it's okay to be confident, but when you're just...
Your nose is so far up in the sky. When you walk in the room, you just feel as though people are just supposed to throw rose petals and bend down on one knee and greet you that way. That's crazy. Because if you hold yourself that high, I think I should hold myself that high also. Mm-hmm. But I don't.
I might get a nosebleed.
It's all about humbling yourself. Mm-hmm. Because if you're not humble, like I said, my motto is the quicker you get it, the quicker you'll lose it. And having your nose so far up in the sky that you can't even see the little people below you. But the little people below you probably are the ones that made you. Mm-hmm. So you can't. And once again, I'm about karma. Because karma, you know what? When I say that, I say that it'd be true. Because I'll give you a situation right now that came across a family situation. So, how can I put this delicately? My aunt was murdered years ago. And the person that they suspected was her husband. So there was no proof on it physically, but they knew he did it. So I get a phone call. Well, I get a text from a family member stating he passed away. So for all these years, they knew he did it, but basically it came out he had cancer and he only had 6 months to live. So basically he overkilled her, got away with it, and then was given cancer.
Wow.
And when I say I'm a avid believer of karma, I feel as though God will, as me and my mom had basically had that conversation, that he will give you a rope.
Sure indeed.
And he'll just give you that rope until he feels as though it's time for him to tighten that rope just enough to say, okay, you did enough, let's go.
Where's this rope? Is it like around your waist or is it around
right around the neck?
Oh.
Meaning he's giving you enough rope, but he's not going to do anything to you right then and there. He's going to let you continue on because he has other people that he has to deal with in the world. Mm-hmm. So, but he's going to get back to you at a later time. And at that later time, he could give you anything. He could do anything to you. But then that thing about karma is it doesn't necessarily have to come back to you. It could come back to another family member.
And it'll just affect you.
Yeah, it will affect you. So when I say treat people a certain way, treat people the way that you want to be treated, that's why I said I'm an avid believer of that, because I don't want any harm coming to me or anyone I love because some dirt that I did, and vastly it will affect me some way, somehow. So, comma, sis. I know you are avid.
I'm a firm believer in karma.
It's something.
Karma is a, you know what, B-I-T-C-H. B-I-T-C-H. It really is.
I even give her respect. I give her a name. Miss Karma.
Oh, Miss Karma.
M-R-S. Mrs. Karma. Dot. Because she's coming. And she comes really fast. There you go.
There you go, Robbie.
There you go. Oh, my God. There you go. So, only you.
I was thinking about it.
Thinking of that?
What are you thinking about?
What was you thinking about? Because she and I was thinking and looking at you at the same time. So, what you was thinking about there, sir? That wasn't a part of karma. That wasn't her.
Who was it?
It wasn't her. I said she was coming. I didn't say how she was coming. There you go. That's so wrong. So wrong. So, what do you think in a relationship, what do you think could cause dysfunctionality in a relationship?
Lies.
What'd he put his head down for?
Yeah, lies. Lies are bad.
And the fact, okay, if someone says to you, hey, baby, I'm in love with you, you know, I enjoy our sexual escapades together. There we go. Play the music. Mm-hmm. And I think I want to bring another person into this.
Skirt.
What? Exactly. Here we go.
Oh, with two people.
No.
What do you say? Or if it's her, what do you say to something like that? And could this be a deal breaker that they want to bring, she or he wants to bring someone else into your bed?
It's like, all right, so I'm talking to my girl, and I'm like, yeah, you know, we've been loving each other for a long time, and I think we should spice it up, bring somebody else, and then she say no, and I'm like, oh, okay then.
I just got a response about the women and men scorn.
Tell them to come.
it can go both ways. It depends on the person. If you are a person that falls in love easy, nine times out of ten, you will be the person scorned. Men get scorned also.
Men do get scorned, but who vastly acts the monkey? The man or the woman, though? Because with that being said, I've never witnessed a guy like just going nuts over some chick cootie coo. You know?
You never witnessed a guy?
I've never witnessed
for yourself?
For myself. I, you know, you always hear about it, but
girl,
I'm sure it's entertaining. I'm sure it's entertaining.
I'm not going to say any names. I had one guy when it was time to be over. And I'm embarrassed to even say he banged on the wall, jumped up and down, laid on the floor, and literally kicked his feet and banged on the floor like he was a toddler. I kid you not even making this up, right hand to, don't want to swear, but yes,
wow.
Like seriously.
That's not deep.
Yes, I was just in disbelief at the time. Like, I felt bad because I didn't mean to hurt him, but I didn't know. I really didn't know. But he's happy married now with a kid, so he's good.
Okay. So, do you, let's say the woman, okay, let's say they end the relationship and once again, you know, they might see each other a couple of years later. So now the person is overweight, balding, wigging it out, whatever the fact, whatever. And the person that, you know, was jilted is doing so much better, but the person that scorned them is doing so much worse. How do you think that person might look at that situation?
Repeat that one more time.
So the person that got scorned, you know, they did their tears and they crying and everything, and you know, the person did the dirt to them. So now is a couple of years later, that person is that was scorned is successful now, and the person that scorned them is balding.
Oh.
You know,
I guess that's their karma.
Bussing it,
that's
or,
their karma.
You know, it's
that might be their karma.
That might be their karma. And you know, they gotta,
and you don't wish bad, you know. You don't be like, that nigga look. I know we've all been in that situation. We know, walk by your ex and you got some sneakers and ran over 3-4 times and he's just like, this, what, where you been? And we're like, oh, call your girlfriend, like, oh my god, I seen such and such, and he looked, yeah.
Busted
and disgusted.
Busted and disgusted.
But you know,
he trying to holler at me.
But in the same token, the right thing to do is say, you know, I'm a pray for you.
I'm pray for you. Stupid.
Pray for you. You get it together.
You know. And then he looking at, she like, what you need to pray for me for? What's wrong with me?
I'm gonna pray you can get some more new shoes. Let me stop.
You're so wrong.
Yeah,
pray that you just get it together. You know.
You know, he could have been like, I just got off of work, you know. Oh, where you work at? Oh, you know, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I just work, you know.
Ooh. I'm sorry.
Oh? Mm. What?
Nothing.
We'll rewind it back. We'll hear it. Yeah, he could have been being a trash man, or, you know, his high-powered job and the recession hit. You know, like, it drops you down a whole couple of notches. And you know what's funny about that? When the recession hit, it's so many people that was severely hit by this recession that were so up here at this level. And are now here, so low, that, you know, it was a poll that with the after effect of the recessions, how different minorities, basically, these fools right here.
I'm whopping it out right now. I'm sorry.
These fools.
That's Robbie.
Robbie.
These
fools. So, the question was, well, the poll was, how did different minorities and different people react to this recession? And sad to say that majority of Caucasian people basically bottomed out, had to get on welfare, committed suicide, domestic violence. But with African Americans and other minorities of the world, it didn't affect them because the struggle for them is every day. Mm-hmm. So them living in public housing or whatever, and you know, they're still getting the government assistance if that was the case. You know, some moved in with the parents, that's not a problem. There's nothing wrong with 8 people in a house. For some people.
You were just down, baby.
Jesus. Jesus.
People.
Jesus.
It's not a problem. But you understand, like, we have always accustomed to a bad situation. We know how to survive.
We sure do. We put our big girl panties on and we deal with it.
And we deal with
whatever
it.
Whatever situation it is, you know. I had a situation today. Woo, I tell you, but thank the Lord, prayer and a little bit of...
And once again, you're more than welcome to share. Okay.
That look was...
No, I'm not.
We're getting ready to go to commercial break.
Oh.
I'm excited for our...
Yes,
oh my God.
Yes. I'm so excited.
I need a push. I need a jolt. I need a...
Yes. Lightning, some volts in my back, exactly. In my neck.
I want to be transformed.
Riley is looking at us like, what are you two talking about? You'll feel it.
I'm looking at you.
We're talking about the international transformer, the ambassador,
Chris Braga. Yes.
And we'll be back. This is your girl, Miss Versatile.
This is your girl, Miss J.
And you're listening live on the Sugar Shack on BeExplosedRadio.com.
We'll be back.
So, you know, I'm a dog, and I'm kind of new to this family, but I've noticed a trend. My humans do this thing where they go around and get all my toys and hide them in this basket, but it's always the same basket. And it's always the same place. And then they act so surprised when I find them. But I'm like, hello? That's where you put it last time. Humans are the worst at hide and go seek.
A person is the best thing to happen to a shelter pet. Be that person. Adopt. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the ShelterPetProject.org.
What's up, everybody? We got a special announcement coming right to you from BeExposedRadio.com.
Hey, this is Sharon. I'm here to tell you about my show, The Sharon Nixon Show.
What is your show going to be about?
We're going to talk about fashion, life, designers, production, anything under the sun we'll talk about here, including our listeners. We're going to have something special for them as well.
Prizes and stuff?
Oh, prizes. Do you know who I am? I'm the queen of gift bags. Okay.
When will this show air?
Every Tuesday at 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
And will there be guests?
Oh, my God, guests. They're going to call in. They're going to be here. Oh, yeah, it's going to be guests.
What station again will this be on?
BeExposedRadio.com.
Again?
BeExposedRadio.com.
Will those police be here, too?
Yeah, they'll be here. Because, okay. You know, I'm down here by the courthouse, so they got to... You know, they got to police the prisoners and stuff.
How can your listeners get in contact with you?
They can dial 855-835-5857. Don't forget to hit extension 1 or else you won't get in. Or you can text us at 443-642-9403.
From north, east, south, and west, you're listening to BeExposedRadio.com.
You are listening to BeExposedRadio.com. The station with all the hits and the talk lately show weeknights at 7 p.m.
So, you know, I'm a dog, and I'm kind of new to this family, but I've noticed a trend. My humans do this thing where they go around and get all my toys and hide them in this basket. But it's always the same basket, and it's always the same place. And then they act so surprised when I find them. But I'm like, hello? That's where you put it last time. Humans are the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
A person is the best thing to happen to a shelter pet. Be that person. Adopt. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the ShelterPetProject.org.
So, you know, I'm a dog, and I'm kind of new to this family, but I've noticed a trend. My humans do this thing where they go around and get all my toys and hide them in this basket. But it's always the same basket, and it's always the same place. And then they act so surprised when I find them. But I'm like, hello? That's where you put it last time. Humans are the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
A person is the best thing to happen to a shelter pet. Be that person. Adopt. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the ShelterPetProject.org.
You are listening to Baltimore Exposed Radio.
See? You miss a minute, you miss a lot, but I got you covered. Check out this snippet of the TLS in the morning.
And the lawsuit with LaBelle continues.
From north, east, south, and west, you're listening to BeExposedRadio.com.
Hello?
Hi.
Oh, okay. Okay. All right. Thanks.
Take care. Bye-bye.
My supervisor.
Hi, I'm Joe Perry.
And Steven Tyler from Aerosmith. Here for RED. Recording artists, actors, and athletes against drunk driving. Yeah, you know we love it when the music does the talking.
And you know, the music stops when someone gets killed.
So never
let someone you know get behind the wheel if they've been drinking.
So keep it real, keep it real.
Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
What's up, everybody? We got a special announcement coming right to you from BeExposedRadio.com.
Hey, this is Sharon. I'm here to tell you about my show, The Sharon Nixon Show.
What is your show going to be about?
We're going to talk about fashion, life, designers, production, anything under the sun we'll talk about here, including our listeners. We're going to have something special for them as well.
Prizes and stuff?
Oh, prizes. Do you know who I am? I'm the queen of gift bags. Okay.
When will this show air?
Every Tuesday at 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Will there be guests?
Oh, my God, guests. They're going to call in. They're going to be here. Oh, yeah, it's going to be guests.
And what station again will this be on?
BeExposedRadio.com.
Again?
BeExposedRadio.com.
Will those police be here, too?
Yeah, they'll be here. Okay. Because, you know, I'm down here by the courthouse, so they got to... You know, they got to police the prisoners and stuff.
How can your listeners get in contact with you?
They can dial 855-835-5857. Don't forget to hit extension 1 or else you won't get in. Or you can text us at 443-642-9403.
You are listening to BeExposedRadio.com, the station with all the hits and the talk lately show weeknights at 7 p.m.
Today in school, I learned a lot. In chemistry, I learned that no one likes me. In biology, I learned that I'm fat and stupid. In English, I learned that I'm disgusting. And in gym, I learned that I'm pathetic and a joke. The only thing I didn't learn in school today is why no one ever helps.
Kids witness bullying every day. They want to help, but they don't know how. Teach them how to stop bullying and be more than a bystander at stopbullying.gov. A message from the Ad Council.
For less than $50 a month, you can have the most intelligent home on the block. With Xfinity, you'll get some of the fastest internet speeds in the nation, so you can stream movies and shows on any of your personal devices and program your DVR on the go. Xfinity even lets you control your lights and temperature and get security and fire alerts from any PC or tablet 24/7, 365. All services are backed by a 30-day guarantee and start at just $49.99. Call today, 866-824-4019. 866-824-4019.
Welcome back. It's your girl, Miss J.
And Miss Versatile.
Live at the Sugar Shack on BeExposedRadio.com. It is a... What kind of weather it is out there? It's a little crazy.
It's kind of... It doesn't know what it wants to do. It's sunny. It has a little overcast. It's dreary. Mm-hmm. But it's still a little daylight.
It's hot.
Yes, it definitely is hot.
It's a little hot. So, what is your dream vacation? If you could take a vacation tomorrow for a week, where would you go? Right now.
Oh, my God. Let me not say my dream. I would want to go for right now. If I can go anywhere I want right now, and I've been there 1,000 times, I would go to Jamaica only because when I go there, I get a jolt. I get refreshed, revitalized. I really tune in with the ocean and the sand and the sun, and building with family, and it's just everything, the food, the air, the everything. And I come back. You saw me there for a second, right? Mm-hmm. Did you just see me? I was there. You saw me there? I was there, but my mouth wasn't on the mic. I was in Jamaica right now, but my mouth was not to the mic. Yes, I'm so sorry. Like, it's just nothing like going home and getting refreshed. So, but if it was a dream vacation, I don't know, anywhere Caribbean. I just love the sand and the beach and the water and all that, and good food. So anywhere in the Caribbean. What about you?
I would love to go to Peru.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's one of my checklists.
Bucket list.
And the very first one is the Great Wall of China.
Beautiful.
Is my first one. The second one is, of course, Africa. That's, you know, some people put that as number one, but I put that as number two.
I actually been to Africa when I was 12. I would like to go as an adult because at that time I didn't appreciate it the way that I would as an adult. I was 12. There were just flies just everywhere, and I was just like, I do remember that was the first time I experienced eating snake, rabbit, and alligator, and frog. We actually went to a restaurant.
It wasn't Africa?
Yes, it's not like I was in a hut, you know what I'm saying, or at somebody's shack or something, and somebody was grilling out in the backyard. We actually went to a restaurant. And they serve these dishes on their menu. They were on their menu, and they served them, and it was I do remember it was okay. It was pretty okay.
And
what about you, Rob? What about you, Robbie?
If I could go anywhere, I want to go to like the Himalayas, like mountaintops, and just see the the clouds and just being so high off the ground.
Now the thing about the vacations, of course, you gotta plan it, you have to pack, you gotta different places you gotta get shots for, you gotta the anticipation of going on this vacation. Then what if you get there, the weather is bad, you can't get a refund, and it was just a suck vacation? How soon do you think you would turn around and plan another one?
I would probably plan one right away to get over that last vacation.
Depends on my budget.
Yeah, of course, the budget. So, what if you couldn't go on vacation and you had to have a sexcation?
A staycation?
Sex.
Oh, a sexcation.
A sexcation.
What's a sexcation?
Very interesting. You know, I'm always finding.
Shout out to Miss J because she always comes with great topics. great topics for
a
the
sexcation.
Show.
A sexcation is you're staying at home, and basically, you're having sex anywhere. You want to rekindle your sex life, and you feel more relaxed and more free at home. So you start ripping off each other's clothes, you jump in bed, but then you think of the vacation destination that you should have went on. So the adrenaline is rushing, and when you're in the mix, so the vacation puts you in the right mindset. I said sex.
Get your baby.
Woo! So while you're on vacation, you experience different things. You're less restrained. You're wilder. You're more adventurous. On a sexcation, you're still thinking about that vacation that you couldn't get away to, but you're with the person that you want to be on vacation with, and you're doing all these things you would have done on your vacation. Mm-hmm. You like that, don't you? Yeah. Here we go. Here we go, R. Kelly. I like that. So on vacations, you normally leave stress less. You have responsibilities at home. But the obstacle is to have great sex. On vacation, that's what you want to do. You want to drink, have good sex, buy some items that you know you're not going to wear in public.
Oh. Your baby.
You're going to get some little trinkets that you're going to give to people you don't really care about, but because they know you're going on vacation, they're texting you while you're on the plane, can you bring me something back? Can you bring me something back? And you get some stale whatever.
It's usually a keychain.
A keychain. Well, I'm not going to lie. Whenever people go away, I know, I'm like, bring me a keychain or a magnet. I would prefer the magnet because then I can put it on my fridge and I can just walk by and see it. I know it's a little corny, but I do like the magnet.
The magnets are cool because that could be pushing you to go to that location.
Exactly.
And so when you go in your kitchen and you look at the refrigerator and you're stressed out, and as you're opening up the refrigerator, you see this destination. It might change your mind as you're going into the refrigerator, but
I like jewelry. I like bracelets.
Mm-hmm.
I like bracelets.
I like bracelets. I love watches. At one point, I stopped wearing watches, and I'm trying to get back into them. Shout out to such and such. But anyway, we have our guests. I'm sorry, I went there for a minute. I'm sorry. We have our guests shortly, Mr. Chris Spraga. Yes, we're getting ready to talk to him in a moment.
I'm so excited. He is the information, international transformer and empowerment ambassador. I love saying that.
I love it. Can you say that three times? No.
International transformer and empowerment ambassador. International transformer and empowerment ambassador.
Ring the bell, ring the bell. Yes. Yes.
Girl, I'm really excited.
I'm so excited.
Go ahead. I'll
go ahead. When you said rejuvenate, I need that so badly today. Because, you know, my day was okay, but it could have been better.
Greetings and thanks for calling. To leave a message in the general mailbox.
So, we're going to try that again.
Was that him, though?
Yes.
Okay.
Try him one more time, because I'm really excited. I've been following him on Facebook, and he has these phenomenal daily quotes that he posts every day to inspire you, to transform you, to ignite you, to get you going. And I'm just excited. So I'm hoping we can get through to him.
Yes. So the reason that I do these topics and I bring, you'll see so many more of inspirational, motivational speakers and relationship experts and authors, because I believe in these people. These people have a dream that a lot of people have, but they don't want to execute that dream and make it happen. So I feel as though the little part of At the Sugar Shack could bring to our listeners of bringing these different people from all over the world who have experienced so many different things. Oh my God. I'm so excited about one guest that I spoke to yesterday, and you will not believe his story, but he won't be on until August. Yes. And I wish I could say his name right now, but when I say At the Sugar Shack, you Shackers, you will not believe who we have coming on this show every day, Monday through Friday. I'm going to bring you one person. I'm going to bring you two people. If I can bring you three people, it's going to benefit your life. I want to be able to touch everyone who listens to our show and can bring some type of laughter, some tears, some anything to brighten your day. Don't do that.
No, I was doing the sound effect for each one. Some don't, laughter, I did a laugh, some tears,
don't
I did
do
a.
That.
No.
Did we get him? Robbie said,
oh. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, and if we can't get him, then we can just talk about.
Greetings and thanks for calling. To leave a message in the general mailbox, dial extension 99 to reach Chris M.
Oh, maybe you have to press something.
Hit the. Unfortunately, we have to do it on air, but hit the button that it says
to contact him. Let's see if it goes through. Sorry, producer Monty. We know you're not really thrilled about that. If you're tuning in and listening.
So, sorry about that. While we're getting our guest.
Wait, you know what I think we should do?
We can talk about some of his daily quotes.
Should we wait until the break?
Unless you plan on speeding it up. No.
Okay.
You can keep trying. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being patient with our special guest. And let's see. 5, 7, 4, 6, 4, 2. Okay. So, yeah. Let's talk about his daily. Okay. I like that. You know why? Because everyone needs some type of inspiration. And whether it's when you wake up and you hear a pastor on the phone, whether you see a religious segment on television, whether you see something that you DVR about inspiration, it could be Oprah, it could be anybody, that you want to get to wake up and start your day off in a positive note. Because so many people have to get prayed up before they go into work. They have to pray as they're leaving the house. They have to pray as they're in the car. They have to pray as they're pulling up to the car, up to the door. They have to pray as they're going in the building. They have to pray before walking in the door of their office. So when you need a lot, when you need a lot of inspiration to get through your day, that says a lot. That either you have a stressful life, a stressful relationship, stressful kids, a stressful dog or cat that you're taking care of, and you just need a little help. So what we're getting ready to do, we're getting ready to take a music break. So this is Miss J.
And Miss Versatile.
Live at the Sugar Shack on Big Exposed Radio. And we'll be back.
Rest in peace to the leader of the Jackson 5. I died in my my sleep, I'm still big pimping. I ball at the mall, beginning of the end. Where the fuck is the sun? It's been a while. Mama, look at your son. What happened to my smile? My tears is tatted, my rag in my pocket. I'm just looking for love, I know somebody got it. Champagne for the pain, weed for the low. God damn, I'm so high, where the fuck did I go? I'm losing myself, I'm stuck in the moment. I look in the mirror, my only opponent. Where the fuck is the press? Where the fuck is the press? Either they know or don't care, I'm fucking depressed. No crying in public, just lying to judges. Risking my life, I'm already dying, so fuck it, well.
Welcome to the jungle, welcome to the jungle, well. God damn it, damn it.
This is Jay.
And you're live in the Sugar Shack on BeExposedRadio.com.
And we are back with our special, special, special guest, Mr. Chris Sprague. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
I believe it's Chris Sprague. Is that it right?
Yes, that'll work. Sprague will work.
Sprague, okay. We want to say and have our listeners get the right, correct saying. It's Chris Sprague.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. So, we are super, super excited about you being such a great author and motivational speaker. Do you mind sharing who you are, what you do, and how you're going to be able to help our lives? Chris, the floor is yours.
Sure, thanks. All right, well, thanks for that intro. I love being the special, special guest. It's a little more special than I usually get, so I'm stoked. This is great. Well, thank you, ladies, for having me on tonight. I'll pause for a second and say that I go out and my job or my passion and my zero point is inspiring and transforming people's lives. I've spent over 40 years in one way, shape, or form on the stage or in front of people and lifting people up and doing everything I can to do the best I can to enhance their lives. And it's so nice to be on your show, to be part of it, because I know it's part of your mission as well, it's part of what you do. So, my life has been, I'll say, interesting at some points. I was bullied as a kid, and I took this really weird detour between being on the stage and being an actor and entertainer through information technology and then back into this passion of mine, which is speaking and sharing a great message. The thing I hope your listeners will get out of tonight's show is that once you find your zero point, once you find that thing that's inside of you, that seed that's inside of you, that's meant to grow into this, either this massive oak tree or maybe a stalk of corn or maybe, a flower, but whatever it is inside of you that's your zero point, that seed, that little thing that's inside of you, once you find it, it's going to unlock your keys to happiness and to success. And you'll figure out what success means to you. Because one of the things that I want to say right off the bat, before we get into your next question, is success does mean different things to different people. If you look at people like Mahatma Gandhi and Martin Luther King and Mother Teresa, success to them was empowering people, and they changed the world by doing that. But if you look at somebody like a Bill Gates or a Richard Branson or Steve Jobs, their seed of success was to be rich and to be very smart from a business and maybe a technology standpoint, and they changed the world in dramatic ways as well. And so it is with everybody listening to me tonight. Whatever that seed of success is inside of you, once you find it, master it, understand it, and accept it, you're going to live a happy life and a successful life, and realize that you can live life on your terms, not what society will tell you is their terms.
Mm. That was powerful, just as an intro. So, what got this thing inside of you that, like you said, over 40 years, to say, I want to do this. I can do this. Did you see someone being a motivational speaker, or did you just, you knew in your heart of hearts that you enjoy speaking to people on a constant basis?
Yeah, the interesting part about that was that even before I took my detour out of being on the stage and entertaining, I had seen people like Tony Robbins and be very, empower people and change their lives. And I knew back then, you're talking 25 years ago, I knew back then that was something I wanted to do, but fear and a lot of other things got in the way. So I took many, many detours, did many, many different things, but I always knew inside of me there was this person dying to come out, this person who wanted to motivate, who wanted to inspire, empower, and transform people, and who wanted to make a difference in people's lives and change their life. Because I'll tell you, the best feeling in the world for me, other than being on stage in front of thousands of people and feeling that energy that comes from being in that environment and giving a crowd every single thing I have and just pouring my heart and soul and everything into them, having them feed it back to me, is when people come up to me and say, Chris, you changed my life. I mean, I start to cry. I mean, I can't tell you how many times I've broken down and just basically cried with somebody because they said, Chris, you've changed our life. And it might have been something small, I said, but to them it was big. And I don't say this to impress you, but to impress upon you that when you find that thing inside of you, when you find your zero point, when you find your DNA, when you find that thing inside of you, you will cry with people because it just makes you happy. I mean, real quick, before we get to your next question, I'm going to give your listeners something else. When you know you found it, people ask me all the time, they say, what would you do if you knew you had 1 hour to live? And I said, well, other than the typical guy thing, you know, the typical guy way to go, you know, if you have 1 hour to live, you do one thing and go that way. Other than that, I tell them, look, put me on a stage, put me on a stool, put everybody who still loves me around me and let me talk until I keel over. Then throw me in the casket, put me in the ground and move on. And people go, wait a minute, wouldn't you want to be out on a beach somewhere? It's like, no, you don't get it. When you found your DNA, when you found your zero point, when you found that thing you were meant to do, you will love to do it until your dying day, and it's the thing that people will say, this is what I want to do, and this is I want to do this until I die, and I want to be doing this when I die, so.
I love it, and on that note, we're getting ready to take a break, and we're going to come right back with Chris. This is Miss J.
And Miss Versatile.
Live at the Sugar Shack on BeExposedRadio.com. We'll be back.
You said you missed the Talk Lately show. Don't worry about it. I got you covered.
I don't... And it's no disrespect to Aaliyah. Goodbye. All right. It's no disrespect to Aaliyah, but I don't believe her career was big enough to warrant a big screen movie. She's not Whitney Houston. I mean, she's not... I mean, you know what I mean? But even Whitney Houston's movie's not going to the big screen, although they're upset about that. But Whitney Houston had a longer tenure than anybody else, although I still wouldn't go see Whitney Houston. I already seen your biopic. It was The Bodyguard. I mean, come on. We don't need another one. You live the same life as your character in The Bodyguard, except for you didn't marry or sleep with your bodyguard. You slept with a junkie instead. Damn, I shouldn't have said that. Rest in peace, Whitney. But you did let a junkie turn you out. I'm just speaking the truth, and if that's not in the biopic, we're going to have a problem. Thank you. The junkie turned her out. and then try to come back and say, I did not turn her into a junkie. She was already one. Which one is it? If I need the truth, and nobody's going to give you the truth. You know that aunt is not going to give you the truth. Her brother's wife, her manager, Bobby Christina surely ain't talking, because she would have to open the closet over her own skinny ass self.
I think they were all just sniffing together.
Even Christina, Bobby Christina?
Yeah.
Because she looked like she's definitely involved in some mischief. Have you seen her? Yes, I've seen her.
With leftovers.
That's the Crypt Keeper's daughter. That girl is so skinny. She's a mess.
Oh, man. Look, you can catch the Talk Lately show Monday through Thursday from 7 o'clock p.m. to 8 o'clock p.m. right here on BeExposedRadio.com.
From north, east, south, and west, you're listening to BeExposedRadio.com.
Hi, I'm LeVar Burton, and I'm proud to be a book person. How do I choose a book? Sometimes it's the cover, sometimes it's the title. I guess I'm pretty visual. If a book's really impressing me and the writing is really good, I will peek and see what the last paragraph is. Because the endings of books should rock you. I am a book person, and if you're a book person too, read to a child and spark a lifetime of ambition. Join me at bookpeopleunite.org, because reading is fundamental. A public service announcement brought to you by Reading is Fundamental, Library of Congress, and the Ad Council.
Green light. Hey girl, school zone. I'm getting hungry. Car changing lanes. You want to meet me for pizza? Stop sign. Intersection clear. Yeah, street. Pizza sounds good. Ball in street? Girl in street!
It's hard to concentrate on two things at once, like texting and driving. Stop the text, stop the wrecks. How will you stop texting and driving? Tell us at StopTextStopWrecks.org. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Driving has a rhythm all its own. Don't wreck it with a text. Before you get behind the wheel, silence your phone. Or better yet, designate a texter. For more text-free driving tips, visit StopTextStopWrecks.org. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration.
Green light. Hey, girl. School zone. I'm getting hungry. Car changing lanes. You want to meet me for pizza? Stop sign. Intersection clear. Yeah, street. Pizza sounds good. Ball in street? Girl in street!
It's hard to concentrate on two things at once, like texting and driving. Stop the text. Stop the wrecks. How will you stop texting and driving? Tell us at StopTextStopWrecks.org. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Whoa.
The moment my son saw a redwood tree.
It's huge!
Is the moment I knew that for him.
You can't even see the top of that thing.
Even the sky has no limit.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org. Learn about forests near you and discover cool things to do when you go. Your moment is out there. Find it at discovertheforest.org.
Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
Free stuff for you just for listening to this station.
Yo, we got your attention?
Here's how it works. You click on the radio loyalty banner right now and sign up. Then you keep on listening like you already do. But now you earn points. Those points add up, and you can trade them in for cool stuff in the radio loyalty store. Earn more points by sharing your station with friends on Facebook and Twitter, answering surveys, and by using the apps in the New Players App Store. Pretty simple. Free stuff just for doing what you already do. Radio loyalty. Click the banner to join now.
You are now listening to Be Exposed Radio.
So, you know, I'm a dog, and I'm kind of new to this family, but I've noticed a trend. My humans do this thing where they go around and get all my toys and hide them in this basket, but it's always the same basket, and it's always the same place, and then they act so surprised when I find them, but I'm like, hello, that's where you put it last time. Humans are the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
A person is the best thing to happen to a shelter pet. Be that person. Adopt. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the ShelterPetProject.org.
Live at the, and we're live here at the Sugar Shack, and we have guest author. I'm sorry, we have our guest today, Chris I'm going to hope I get this last name right. Chris Sprague. Did I say that right? I'm so sorry, Chris.
You got it right the first time.
Thank you so much. And I love this title. He is the International Transformation and Empowerment Ambassador. And I love that. And he's here today giving us tips on how to transform and empower our lives. And we can do that by... We can do that by powerful affirmations and just being positive. And I'm just so excited about having you on today.
Oh, thanks. I'm excited too. So what do we got next? What's the next question?
Well, oh, okay. So with that being said, and what do you think is the most powerful thing that you could tell someone from your experience and the message that you're trying to bring to the world?
Yeah, the most powerful thing I could tell someone is this. You can be whatever you want to be within your wiring. Now, here's what I mean by that. A lot of people, when I first started saying that, said, oh, you're limiting people. And actually, I'm not. I'm freeing people. Because when you look at somebody who's struggling, when you look at somebody who's down on their luck, when you look at somebody who can't find what to do next in life, you look at somebody who's been laid off, the worst thing you can do is look at that person and say, you can be whatever you want to be. Because the reaction, their subconscious reaction is, yeah, you idiot. If I could be whatever I wanted to be, you know, they look at you and go, okay, you know, just tell me I'm an idiot. Okay, I can be whatever I want to be. That makes me feel even worse because I can't be even one thing. And the point here is this, is once you find how you're wired, once you find your zero point, that sets you up and gives you the blueprint to understand what you can be, what you will be, and what you're going to be. And that is the key. It removes all the stress, all the frustration, all the anxiety of, geez, if I can be anything I want to be, then why am I still a failure? They just did a study recently, and they said most depressed people, the worst thing you can say to them is just be happy, because their mind is thinking, well, look, if I could be happy, I would be happy. The problem is, it's the same way with people who are struggling to find out what's next in life and struggling to find out what they want to do. The minute you tell them they can be anything they want to be, you put the weight of the world on their shoulders, and you don't want that. So what you want to do is you want to understand that once you find your zero point, you find out what's inside you, and find out what you were meant to be, then within that wiring, within that blueprint, you can do anything you want. And that's going to lead to a life of happiness.
Chris, this is Miss Versatile. When did you start writing your book, and how long did it take you to actually finish?
Yeah, that's the interesting one. So I never thought of myself as a writer. So every time I sat down to write, I'd write three sentences and go, I'm done. And I always just said, I'll never be a writer. And then the book you're talking about, The Secret Blueprint to More, I sat down in front of what every great writer does and the program that every great writer uses to create their next best book, Microsoft PowerPoint. Yes, there's a little sarcasm in there. But here was the thing. When I sat in front of PowerPoint, there's a background that opened up my mind and opened up my creativity. It looks like a piece of parchment. And for whatever reason, the minute my brain saw that parchment, it just started to write. And in less than 30 days, I wrote and had the book done. And that's because, and I did say less than 30 days.
Wow.
And back then, when I did it, I didn't even use all these systems that tell you how to write a bestseller in a weekend, so to speak. But it just came out. And that was, I think, my first exposure to understanding my own wiring and understanding that how I was wired, that if I wanted to write, I needed something to open up my creativity and just to forget about spelling mistakes and everything else, at least up front, and just start writing. So, yeah, the short answer is it took me, once the creativity opened up, it took me less than 30 days. It took me longer to edit it and took me longer to get the fun. It took me longer to actually edit it and do the other fun stuff along with it. But the writing took less than 30 days.
Wow, that's amazing.
That's a beautiful thing.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
Well, our next question was, did you ever experience writer's block? even though it was less than 30 days, but during those 30 days, did you experience writer's block at all?
Yeah, once or twice. It just kind of, you know, you get to something, and I do say for the majority of times, the words did just flow. But there was a couple times where, okay, I've got to put it away for a night or a couple of days and come back to it. The biggest period of writer's block I experienced was before writing this book, was just the fact of I would write two or three sentences and then I couldn't think of anything else and I'd go, okay, it's done. And to get rid of that writer's block, like I said, that was the whole parchment, the creativity piece. But I think every great writer, even the ones that write books quickly, experience writer's block from time to time.
For all of those people who want to write, like myself, I really want to write a book. So if that suggestion is of how to skip Chase and write a book during the weekend, I definitely need that book because it's very frustrating. So yeah, I definitely understand.
I'll give you the quick outline here. This is your bonus for tonight. Didn't even plan on talking about it, but I'll give you your bonus for tonight. So here's the really, really short version, and if you want to talk about it offline, we can, or if you want to, we can maybe look at doing something else. The really short version is you get out a bunch of note cards, you write down basically 10 major topic titles, which is your 10 chapters. You end up tearing up the two weakest ones. On the 8 remaining, you write basically one or two more bullet points. You take more note cards, I should say. You write down a few more bullet points. Once again, you take out the weak ones. In the end, you boil it down to pretty much 8 chapters and, you know, 3 or 4 bullet points about each chapter that are fairly strong. And you phrase the bullet points in the form of a question. And then you work with somebody and have them ask you those questions. You record your answers, and then you transcribe the recordings, and there you have your book. Now, there's also a method. I know I went through that really quick, but you got a recording, so you can listen to it. The other thing is through the Professional Practice Builder Society. Myself and my co-creator, Dr. Mark Kosman, have come up with a couple of different methodologies to help people create content very quickly, which also can apply to a book. So one of them is the 1-4-3 method, and the other is the IBAT method. And just real quick, the 1-4-3 method is one major topic area, 4 episodes, 3 bullet points about each episode. So what, in effect, you do is you can create a year's worth of content by saying, what am I going to talk about each month? Out of what I'm going to talk about each month, the overarching theme, what are the 4 main points I want to get across to the people during the month, the 4 episodes? And then you go back and you take the each of those 4 episodes and say, okay, what are the 3 key bullet points I want people to understand about those episodes? And then you start creating content like that. You can use that same system to write yourself a quote-unquote book in a weekend. And the beautiful part is if you work with myself and Dr. Mark, we end up showing you how to create content that you can massively distribute and take that content map, as we call it, and massively distribute it. I mentioned the IDAT method. Just one more thing real quick. Stands for Identify, Define, Articulate, and then Package. And what it boils down to, what that system teaches you, what we teach you in that system, is how to speak in your ideal customer's language, in your ideal client's language. So when you couple the two, the 1-4-3 method and IDAP, it also gives you a great and powerful way to create boatloads of content, and you can even turn that content into one or many books. We've got a few clients right now that we're working on publishing, you know, somewhere between 1 and 12 ebooks for them. So,
wow, thank you so much, and I'm definitely going to take you up on that. How have you marketed your work in the beginning, and have you written a book you love, but yet you didn't get published?
Yeah, the marketing is a two-part thing. At the beginning, I did it all wrong. I put it up on Amazon, tried to do some good, as they say, search engine optimization, and figured, well, I got a great book. If people find, I'll put it up there. there and people will come. It's on Amazon. People will search for it. Not a problem. It'll be a bestseller in no time. And it never went anywhere. So then the second step was the way I would suggest everybody do their marketing. It's still on Amazon. Excuse me, but the short version is what you want to do is you want to reach out to your connections on social media, whether it be LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, and what have you, and say, look, from 10 a.m. to noon on Friday, you know, or on 10 a.m. to noon on Wednesday the 10th, I want you to go and download a copy of my book for free, or I want you to buy this book for 99 cents because I want to make it a bestseller. And I'll give you the dirty little secret to becoming a bestseller. If you get enough people within a short enough time span to buy your book, you'll become a bestseller. And it might not be glamorous, but the fact of the matter is it's all in the way Amazon deals with things. So I probably just shattered a lot of people listening. I probably just shattered your perception of bestsellers. But you know what? I want to give everything I can to people. So I'll give this to you. Plain and simple, you can become a bestseller by just having enough people in a short amount of time buy your book. I got mine up to, you know, I got mine up to bestseller status within an hour or so of doing that. And it's something that if you have great content, people will then continue to buy, and then you'll come up alongside suggestions of other, you know, of other great books. So it's something that, you know, it's something that at this point, that's kind of the way to do it. And you know what? If you go up and then you fall off real quick, that's okay, because the point is that at least you did it, and you'll know, you know, maybe better what will work and what won't work in the future. With regards to books that I haven't published, you know, I've got three in the can right now that are about my. Some of them are actually about the and will be about the struggles that I've experienced over about the last 18 months or so. But 18 months ago, just a real quick, about 18 months ago, my now ex-wife, yes, I did say ex-wife. Oh, you really got to look at that picture. I said ex-wife. So look me up. Thank you very much. That's my dating segment of the show. She came to me and she said, look, if you don't stop this, you know, professional speaking and doing what you're doing, get a real job, I'm leaving you. And I was heartbroken at the beginning, and my first reaction was, you know, what can we do to save this? My second reaction was, because it was 3 days after I had shown her the copy of my book and dedicated that book to her, so I felt like saying, why couldn't you have told me 3 days ago what the heck happened in the last 3 days after you saw the fact? So I was pretty much blindsided. Right now, I you know what, reversal of the tone of my voice, I have no ill will. I wish her all the best, because we've gone, and now we're in completely different places. The divorce is final. She's moved on. You know, I've moved on and really focused on my career and everything else, and I'm still looking for Mrs. Wright, which will be great.
She's coming.
The point is this, is that, yeah, she is. She's out there somewhere. I know. And you know, I'll get her from one of these radio shows yet, but so I got to throw my little dating. I got to throw my dating segment
in front of them.
So here's the thing of it. What it boils down to is this, is that if I'd understood how I was wired a lot sooner, that wouldn't have happened. And because I didn't, things took a lot longer than they should have. And it just became too much. So I know that once I'm comfortable enough to release the books, you know, there's nothing bad in them. There's no derogatory things towards my ex-wife writing. It's just a lot of, you know, very cathartic writing of what people can expect to go through and how to avoid and overcome it. To get through it, because here's what I think, Ms. Versatile and Ms. J. I almost called you that other way, that Ms. J and Ms. J Z. I had a sound like that. Now you can transcribe it, put Jay Z in it and get more traffic. I just lost my complete train of thought. But what it boils down to is this, I think we all, you were talking about, and I'm going to change what I was going to say, but you were talking about books, and I think everybody has a book somewhere inside of them, even if they're not a writer, and I think that, you know, oh, that's what I was going to say. So I think that if you use, I think that if you're wired to do it, if you're wired to help people, you need to use your personal experiences to do that. For the longest time, I was afraid of letting anybody in, afraid of letting people see my imperfections, afraid of letting people see my flaws, afraid of looking at people and telling them all the things that I, you know, all the times I was bullied, all the things I did wrong. And what I realized was I was robbing people of the chance to learn from my past mistakes, my pain, my frustration, my stress. And the more I robbed them, the less people I could help. So now I'm as open I'm as open of a book as possible, and you know, I do everything I can to use my negative experiences to help other people, because that's what I believe they were put here in my life for. And if I can at least help even one other person either avoid divorce or find a better relationship or inspire their lives or empower their lives or transform their lives through my words and through the stuff I've gone through, then it will be worth it. Then the hundreds of thousands of dollars I lost, the houses, the friends, the everything. I mean, when I say I lost everything, I mean, I'm talking every worldly thing you can think of losing, I lost. And it's something that it was a terrible time. It was a very dark time, but using it to help other people is what gives me hope that it wasn't for nothing.
Well, I'd like to thank you and, of course, extend the offer for you to be a permanent at the Sugar Shack contributor on our show when you're free. Definitely enjoy this conversation. Of course, we would love to pick this up on a constant basis. And I would like for you to tell our listeners how they'll be able to locate you, to find you, to follow you.
Excellent. And before I do that, thank you very much, Ms. Versatile, Ms. J. It's been an incredible night. Thank you for letting me go. I know sometimes I can tend to hijack shows because I'm a public speaker. I try and tone it down a little bit, but you guys are so you ladies are so accommodating. It's been wonderful. So thank you very much. And let's definitely talk offline. I'd love to figure out how being a regular contributor would be helpful and kind of the nights and everything. So let's definitely make a point to talk offline. I would love to do it, even if it's just a small 5, 15, 10-minute segment, so I don't hijack your entire show every time I'm on. Even if you want to keep it small, that'd be great. I'd love to share everything I can with your listeners. As far as your listeners, if I've resonated with you in any way, you're welcome. So as far as your listeners go, if I've resonated with you in any way and you want to reach out and contact me, I would love to hear from you. Go to chrismsprague.com. That's chrismsprague.com. That's CHRISM, and somebody else has said make it happen, sprague.com. You can find links to everything out there, the PPB Society that I JV with Dr. Mark, where we help coaches and everything explore their businesses. That's the best way of getting a hold of me and of finding me. And once again, thank you. It was a wonderful night.
Thank you so much, Chris. We appreciate you. So, this is Ms. J.
And Ms. Versatile.
And we're getting ready to take a break, and we'll be back in a minute. Thank you, Chris.
Hold the line.
You're welcome. Thanks, ladies. Talk to you soon.
Okay.
Only in the forest can you see this. But nothing beats the moment you see that.
Cool!
That's your child's eyes opening up to a world of possibilities.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org. Learn about forests near you and discover cool things to do when you go. And you might just see this. Visit discovertheforest.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
Only in the forest can you see this. But nothing beats the moment you see that.
Cool!
That's your child's eyes opening up to a world of possibilities.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org. Learn about forests near you and discover cool things to do when you go. And you might just see this. Visit discovertheforest.org.
Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
Hi, I'm LeVar Burton, and I'm proud to be a book person. How do I choose a book? Sometimes it's the cover, sometimes it's the title. I guess I'm pretty visual. If a book's really impressing me and the writing is really good, I will peek and see what the last paragraph is. Because the endings of books should rock you. I am a book person, and if you're a book person too, read to a child and spark a lifetime of ambition. Join me at bookpeopleunite.org because reading is fundamental. A public service announcement brought to you by Reading is Fundamental, Library of Congress, and the Ad Council.
Welcome back, welcome back. This is your girl, Miss J.
What's this time?
Live at the Sugar Shack on BeExposedRadio.com. We had a great day today. And our beautiful guest, Miss Denise DaCosta, is on the line. Welcome, 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 Denise.
Hi there. How are you?
Great. Thank you for blessing us with your presence, and you're a beautiful author. Please tell our Shackers who you are and what it is you do.
Okay, my name is Denise Carey Costa. I'm currently on location in Arizona filming a movie called Tony's Tale, Tragedy in Arizona, which is based on my book of the same title. And it chronicles the trial and execution of a pit bull named Tony under false pretenses that he is an aggressive dog. We're pretty much doing the movie to get the message out there that pit bulls are being killed every day just based on their breed. And there's a lot of injustice going on towards humans and the animals because they're being seized from their families and then killed for no reason other than the breed that they represent.
Mm. So how old was Tony?
He was 8 years old.
8 years old. So in human life, he would have been?
About 56.
56. Wow. That's a long...
It was a very...
Very long life. So
yeah, it was a very, very tragic case. A lot of wrongdoing, a lot of injustice. So that's what we want to expose in our film.
So with that being said, I'm sure there's been a lot of outpour in for Tony. Quickly, how long did this happen, and what repercussions have happened since this tragedy?
It happened in 2011 and carried over into 2012. The dog was impounded from the family in 2011. They went through a lengthy court process. A lot of evidence wasn't presented that should have been presented on behalf of Tony, but the judge did not hear did not hear reason or logic, and she went ahead and had the dog executed in June of 2012.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a lot of worldwide outcry, a lot of outpouring of sympathy for his owner, Michelle Dozier, and her family, that they had to suffer through this. So it made a lot of news worldwide. People are still interested in the case, which is why we've gone forward with the film after the book was published. There's still a lot of interest in the topic.
How did you become involved? I know that you're an advocate. I'm sorry, this is Ms. Versatile. I know you're an advocate for animals, so how did you, in fact, become involved in even getting the story
As an advocate for animals, I get a lot of online petitions from various groups to sign, petitions on behalf of animals or for better living conditions for animals. And I came across the petition for everyone was petitioning the court to grant Tony a stay of execution because he was not the aggressive dog that the courts portrayed him as. So I signed the petition, and then a few months later I saw the follow-up that he had indeed been killed by the court. And it really, really broke my heart and also angered me, which prompted me to contact Tony's owner, Michelle Dozier, to see if I could publish the story based on her experience and get Tony's story out there to the world so he would not be forgotten and the people who did this to him would have to live with the shame of knowing that they killed an innocent dog and pretty much ruined a family.
Well, we have to wrap it up, but I definitely would like to bring you back. Denise, how can our listeners be able to find you and be a part of this topic?
Yeah, there's a lot of there's a lot of Facebook pages, social media that follow this particular topic. People can find me on Facebook under Denise Carey Costa. I always welcome new friends on my Facebook page. They can contact me through a message. I also have a website called talesfortales.net, and it talks about my books, my advocacy work, and my current projects, and they can also send me an email through that. There's an option to email me. So I always welcome, you know, letters from the public, either for or against what I'm doing, and that way we can either discuss it further or I can hopefully sway their thinking in a different direction.
All right. Well, thank you, Denise, so much. Like I said, we're going to follow
welcome.
Back
thank
up with
you. Thank you for having me on the show.
Oh, you're
you so
welcome.
Much.
And I'll follow
right,
up with
have
you.
Have a blessed day.
You too.
Thank you. You too.
All right. Thank you so much. I'll go ahead and follow up then.
Okay.
For a future date.
All right.
All right. Thank you.
No
bye
problem. Bye bye. This is your girl, Miss J, with Miss Versatile, live at the Sugar Shack on BeExposedRadio.com.
What a great show today. We'll see you tomorrow.
And the Talk Lately show is coming up next. Yeah, have a great evening.
Thank you.